This is Samoa Joe, and you're listening to the Ringside Report.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. 3, 2, 1. Hello?
1, 2. Check. Yep. Check. Yeah, 1, 2.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hey, John, we got a big show. We got a big show to do. We got a lot to do. Welcome, everybody. It's the Wrestling Uncensored pre-show, and I'm going to cover New Japan on this edition because... I didn't do the extra podcast, so we're just going to do it here. A bonus, extra, loaded edition of Wrestling Uncensored. We'll get to the WWE stuff in a bit. And Johnny North, you've got a lot to cover, too. You got matches that you just had and a movie review, from what I understand. So,
yeah, I saw the new Pacific Rim Uprising movie.
Okay.
I don't know if you saw the first one or know of it.
No.
Think of, you know, giant robots, aliens, and it's like Godzilla kind of fights or Power Rangers kind of stuff. Think like that.
Who has the giant robots?
The humans do.
So the humans are using giant robots to kill aliens?
But here's the twist now, because that's what happened in the first one.
Okay.
The twist now is now the robots are attacking the humans for some unknown reason.
Well, that sucks for the humans. So all the humans die? Or they survive somehow.
Now they got to figure it out. You know, some humans die. It's going to happen.
Well, of course.
This kind of movie series.
So they got robots and aliens attacking them this time?
Pretty much, yeah.
Sounds terrible. Like for the humans. Was it a good movie?
I enjoyed the action. It's just when you get into the drama part, talking about how like, oh, this guy likes this girl, but this guy also likes that girl. It's just not that interesting.
So there was like a love story mixed in with the robot alien fighting?
And, like, a teacher-student thing as well.
What?
There's a lot of stuff going on. So, that stuff's not as interesting. It's just, like, just destroy stuff. People die. We'll have fun and then sort it out through there. But, no, let's all make jokes in the in-between about how this guy, like, I'm cuter than this guy. Or this guy has better hair. Like, that kind of stuff takes away from the movie. Like,
what?
I know, like, there's stupid jokes about that. When there's buildings and people are dying, but they have to, you know, one-up each other. So
that's kind of weird.
That kind of took away from it. I guess they try to make it kind of funny, but it should be more serious, I think. But I guess they try to market it more towards, like, PG-13 than rated R. But if you enjoyed the action of the last one, I imagine this is just much more better.
Yeah, okay. Did you see the first one?
I did not see the first. Well, you saw like clips, you know, in the beginning, like
of the movie.
Of the movie, yeah.
They show clips from the first movie.
Yeah, it's kind of like a prologue kind of thing. They just to start it off.
Oh, okay.
So you get the idea of everything, what's going on, or what happened.
Mm-hmm.
But wow, just amazing towards the action. I highly enjoyed that. If you just like seeing just a lot of destruction and chaos, it's definitely worth watching.
Yeah.
Just not for the story, though. The story sucks.
Was it long?
Probably an hour and a half.
That's not bad. All right, then. So what do you give it out of 5 Johnny North biceps?
3.
Wait, that doesn't make sense.
3?
3 biceps out of 5?
Yeah.
3 bicep curls?
Yeah.
Out of 5. That's decent. But your 50 Shades gets 5, right?
Well, what do you think?
Yeah. You love it. You love it. What's a 4?
I don't think we've got a 4 yet.
Oh, okay. I don't think we have done ratings for any of the other movies. I think I just came up with it now.
I think you've always said this is terrible, like, all the time.
What have I said is terrible?
For everything I've ever done.
It's everything always... you've ever done? I don't think so. Why would I keep having you on the show every week? Why would we do the show every week together if I think everything you do is terrible? That makes no sense, Johnny North.
Because the fans want it. The fans love it.
The fans... Because of the fans, the legions of fans, that's why we do the show together? Is that what you think?
I believe so.
Yeah?
Well, that's why I do the movie reviews still. I'm pretty sure I wouldn't have done movie reviews anymore if people were like, oh, this is terrible. David's right. Can Johnny North.
No, people love the movie reviews, and I've never advocated for your canning. I've advocated for your caning. That's different. Want to see you get hit with a Singapore cane in a wrestling match.
Thanks.
Well, I mean, it's fun. It's fun times. And then you hit him back.
Sometimes.
Sometimes you do. Sometimes you don't. How'd your matches go?
Well, there was Friday, CRW, and the good news is there was heating.
There was heating in the building. There was
heat in the building.
So this was the building that had no heat for most of the winter, and that's why the promotion couldn't run in that building.
That's correct.
So the promotion went on hiatus for a little while.
Haven't had a show there since October.
Wow. So they came back, and why was there heating now, miraculously?
I guess a lot of complaining happened.
Okay.
So
there was heat in the building. So you got to wrestle in, I guess, just pants, no shirt, right?
Pretty much.
But you weren't freezing cold when you were doing it.
Well, I was also wrestling three matches because I was in a tournament, Super 8 tournament, so.
Oh, three matches, so you got to the finals.
I did, and thankfully I wasn't freezing all the way up to the finals, which was great.
So how did that go?
Well, first match, I wrestled this guy, Hassan. He's the promoter that I wrestled in the Toronto show for.
Okay.
So that was a lot of fun to wrestle him. Never wrestled him before. It was interesting. I don't think he realized how hard I hit chops, but he realized once the match got going. And
he failed to realize.
Oh, but he realized just, you know, a little later on, that's all. But that was good, though. I think it motivated him. It pushed him to work hard.
Uh-huh.
And we had this fun moment where I threw him on the outside, and I tried to bring him back in, but the fans, like, grabbed him by the arm, and then I grabbed him by the arm. So we almost had, like, a tug-of-war with him. That was fun, just the little interactions like that. You don't really plan that kind of stuff, but it's interesting what some fans will do.
And you went over.
In that match, yeah, I went over. So I went to the semifinals.
How did you win? STL 1-2-3?
That's right.
Boom. That's the way it should be. That's what I'm talking about. Man, I feel like 2018 is your most winningest year so far. You're winning a lot of matches this year.
I feel in 2010 I won a lot, too.
Okay. So this is your winningest year since 2010.
Yeah, sounds right.
It's 8 years, John.
Yeah.
Well, that's good. We're starting off 2018 on the right foot, my man. Yes, victory. And then the semifinals, another victory.
It was a victory, but I got laid out kind of thing that happened.
Aww.
Because, this is a really fun part about the match. I'm wrestling a guy, Rick Lucas. Now, we don't really get along too well in the past. We've had an issue in the past.
For real?
Yeah, you were actually there at the show where we had that issue. So
what?
Yeah,
I don't remember this.
Yeah, you were ring announcing, I believe, one time.
And you had an issue with a guy?
Yeah.
I don't remember you having an issue.
He was supposed to do a spot, and he didn't do the spot. So then I had to change the finish because he didn't live up to his end of the agreement. So you don't remember that?
No.
Oh, wow. You were there, though. Anyways.
I don't remember it being a deal. I don't remember a deal.
We hadn't wrestled since, but they just out of nowhere told me, okay, you guys are wrestling each other. And, you know, we just plan out a match and everything. And what I was told going into this by Jeremy Prophet was he wanted a brawl, just pretty much a brawl for the match. So we plan it out like that. And we can't break anything because everything's fragile. If we, like, hit each other into the walls or something, we'll probably go through the walls at this venue. Can't break any chairs or anything, so.
Okay.
It's brawling without actually causing damage. That's pretty much what we have to do. Now, I go through the curtain, and I think Paul Rossetti, the other promoter, he may have said something of, don't brawl, but I'm not 100% sure if I heard him or not, so. Anyways, apparently he was saying something, and I already have in my head, like, well, we're doing this. So we're pretty much brawling around the crowd, and Paul, at the top of his lungs, are yelling. He's yelling at me, like, get the F back in the ring right now. Start the match off here. Don't brawl in the crowd. My idea was, we're going to brawl in the kitchen. They have, like, a little, like, kind of bar set up. So,
right, but aren't they scared to have that damage for some reason? Wasn't that an issue last time you wrestled in this promotion?
Yeah. So.
So you're doing it again.
Well, because, like, they decide to book me in a match just out of nowhere. Like, we had heat. Thankfully, like, there was no issue with Rick and everything. But the fact that they didn't tell me ahead of time, and to me, that's taking a liberty. So I'm going to take a liberty back on you.
Wow.
And we're going to, you know, brawl just in the kitchen area.
Vengeful.
A little bit. And I may have scared a couple of people there who didn't.
People, what people? Fans?
Just the cooks there.
People that were working.
Yeah, the staff that was working there. They were scared a bit because we were right there pretty much where they're serving the food. We didn't break anything. But then I believe I heard Paul again, like, you guys better get the F back in the ring right now or I'm calling off the match. Top of his lungs, like, everybody can hear this.
Wow.
So, you know, I think Rick did the right thing by bringing me back, and we pretty much just started the match off. But the match just, the idea of the match is, like, we get in the ring, I hit him with the STO, he rolls out, and then he goes and gets chairs, and hits me with a chair, and then just covers me in chairs, and that's how it ends.
Okay.
So there isn't much of a match.
So that's what happened?
That's what pretty much happened, yeah. And because of being covered in chairs...
How was that?
Well, that you know, tickled a little bit, of course.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What happened? He hit you with a chair, and then he started throwing chairs all over you?
Yeah, he just started throwing chairs
all over. Just throwing chairs on you?
Yeah. I'm pretty much just covered in chairs by the end of it.
You get hit in the head?
I got hit in the arm a little bit, and I still got somewhat of a bruise right there, as you can see.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
Yeah. And it was a little numb, but, you know, I could still move it. So what I decided to do was, well, I'm going to really sell the crap out of this, where I just really oversold it and just act like I couldn't move my arm. And by the time, like, people uncovered me, refs uncovered me, and they asked me, you know, are you okay? I'm like, no, I'm not okay. I can't feel my arm. And, Can you continue? I'm like, no, I cannot continue. Like, but they've already ended the match, by the way. I've won by DQ already. And, like, they're freaking out because they don't think I can, like, get up or anything. I'm told, like, you're going to have to help me up. Like, I can't move.
Wow.
And then they get me, like, I guess I thought it was an ice pack, but apparently they didn't have ice. They decided to get snow instead from outside.
What?
Yeah. I figured it was ice, but... It was it because afterwards I wanted to if they give me some new ice because it was all wet at the end and they're like, oh, we don't have any ice. Like, what are you asking for ice for? I'm like, you gave me ice. Like, no, we gave you snow. Thanks, guys.
Snow in what? Like a bag?
In a plastic bag.
Good job.
Yeah.
Wow. We don't have ice.
I was very surprised.
Who doesn't have ice?
You're serving food. Like, I don't get it. I guess the drinks are very warm.
Yeah, remind me not to get food there next time I go. No, thank you.
But
yeah, we got some food that's been sitting here for 3 days. You want it?
No, thank you.
Yeah.
So I get backstage, and you know, I'm like, Jeremy asked me first, like, "Are you okay?" I'm like, "Yeah, I'm okay." So then everyone's kind of. Some people are pissed because I work them, and Paul told me. That, I knew you were working, like, the whole time. And then Jeremy told me afterwards, like, Paul thought, like, everything was ruined. The show was, like, you weren't going to continue at all. So Paul worked me in that sense that he thought, like, he knew I was just working it. But
my God. You know, I hate this wrestling world where you just lie to each other and you say, oh, I'm just working you, brother. It's just working. But you're basically just lying to each other. I mean, I understand what you were doing and everything.
I was hurt.
But then you saying that he came up to you later and said, oh, I knew you were just working everybody. Well, that's a lie. That's not working. There's no, you know what I mean? You're saying, oh, he worked me later. No, he lied to you later. He just told a lie to you that you caught him in. But I find a lot of people in wrestling, it's a very carny kind of industry, industry, business, side hustle, whatever it is, hobby, whatever you want to call it. But a lot of people in it, they say, oh, I'm just working you. Oh, I'm just healing out. No, you're being an asshole or you're lying. Being a heel, it's not, if you're not on TV, if you're not in a ring, you're not a heel, you're a dick. You know what I'm saying? Right. You're not working somebody. Oh, I told them this, but it's not really true. I'm working them. No, you lied to them. This is real life. This is, you know, the real world. You know what I'm saying? That type of shit I don't like. It's stupid. It's like, hey, man, just be a real person. The whole world isn't wrestling. You don't live a character. You don't live a gimmick. And if you do, you need to check yourself because you're not a real person then.
But you understand why I did what I did, right?
Like, yeah. That's wrestling. That makes sense to me because the more everybody else believes, the more everybody believes. So it's good. It works. What you were doing... Mm-hmm. Makes sense. I'm not taking issue with what you're doing. I'm taking issue with what you said by when Paul said to me, oh, I knew you were working the whole time. And then you're like, oh, Paul was just working me there. No, he wasn't working you. He lied to you, John. That was a lie in that instance. working somebody is saying, oh, I'm hurt, you know. But then when you go backstage, you're like, no, I'm not that hurt. It's cool. Right?
Right.
But in the ring, in front of the crowd, you act like you're hurt. So the referees around you aren't going to act like, oh, you're not hurt. Because then the crowd doesn't believe that you're hurt. You know what I'm saying? Like, you working the refs gives them a genuine reaction, which allows the crowd to feed off of that and see that, oh, man, this guy's really hurt. Will he make his match later on?
Well, that's another thing, too. I have another match, right? So it was my idea of, like, well, I need something story-wise to go into this because there's one match before the final match before I go out again. So I pretty much have maybe 10, maybe 15 minutes before I got to go out for the other match. So I don't have a lot of time to prep for that final match. So that was the idea. It was like, let's give it a story at least.
That's good.
I thought so.
I thought so too. I like it.
So then I go up against Jagged in the finals.
Yeah.
And as I've told you, Jagged, he's wrestled on NXT before.
Yeah.
You've seen him on Raw and SmackDown quite a few times. So
I haven't seen him on Raw or SmackDown quite a few times.
He was actually one of the security guards against Goldberg.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, against Goldberg.
Well, remember, like, they got Goldberg and he, like, clotheslined him and Goldberg, like, hurt his shoulder? I called him out on that, too. I'm like, which one of you guys injured him? Like,
okay, so he was a security guard. But he actually worked wrestling matches in NXT, right? It was a tag team?
I believe they wrestled the Revival, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
F the Revival.
Oh, it's your choice. I don't think they're that bad, but okay.
Well, you know.
But it was so easy to wrestle him because, one, it's just like pretty much I'm selling the arm the whole time. And you know, I'm trying to fight against him, but he's, you know, obviously hitting it or taking any advantage he can on it. So it's always that uphill kind of battle throughout the whole match. So, but eventually he got the better of me.
Yeah, he beat you.
Now, I did go a little overboard because near the end, my last like gasp of like offense, I'm supposed to like charge him in the corner and like spear the corner, but he moves out of the way. Now, I ran kind of fast, and I put my hand there, but I went really fast that my head still hit the post anyways, that it moved the ring, and I felt like this goose egg in the back of my head, so that hurt. Then I'm like, well, that's karma, you know, like, I told people I was hurt, and I wasn't really that hurt, and now it's like, now I really need that ice, and I still don't have ice.
How's your head feeling now?
It actually feel pretty good. It just, what was rough was that was Friday, right? I got to wrestle Sunday afternoon as well. So Saturday is just my day of rest.
Yeah. You didn't even go to the gym?
I did go to the gym, yeah.
It's not a day of rest. You're going to the gym. You're working out.
To be honest, like, the gym actually helps, like, with recuperation. Because a lot of that is, like, just maybe 30 minutes of stretching, which is, like, key.
Yeah.
So, and then, you know, light weights at best, pretty much, you know, just to make sure, like, I can actually move stuff and I'm confident. And for some reason, I don't know where, but my knee hurt like hell, too. So I'm having trouble, like, moving my arms, walking. My head hurts. I'm worried about bumping. I'm really worried about wrestling Sunday. But I'm wrestling Drew Onyx, so I'm like, well, he's one of the best. This shouldn't be that bad. And I get there, too, and he's like, oh, I heard you went through a tough match and all that. You had a tough week. Like, don't worry about it. Make this pretty simple. And I'm like, oh, that's cool, but can we do more? So we did a lot more. And I underestimated him. And that was a big mistake on my part.
What do you mean?
Because I had this idea, like, okay, I'm going to, you know, tack you first, you know, whip you to the corner. And I do this chop to the back thing. And he's like, oh, okay, you want to chop me in the back? Yeah, sure, no problem. I'm like, okay, cool. And I didn't realize that he'd get me back for it later in the match.
Of course.
Most people don't. They're just, they take it and that's it.
Yeah, so. Drew Onyx is a big, tough guy. You know, he's a pro wrestler. He's a real pro. He's been around for a while. Yeah, I'm sure he can give it back just as much as he can take it.
Well, he gave it back quite a bit. I was like all bruised, like on my chest right there.
You're showing me your chest right now. Oh, you are bruised. I see a handprint of Drew Onyx on your chest.
It was actually like all beat red on Sunday. So,
wow.
Yeah. So,
yeah. How'd that feel? Good?
surprising. I'm like, wow, like, you hit pretty hard. He's like, of course I hit pretty hard. What do you expect?
Why were you surprised that, like, how much does this guy weigh? He's a huge guy.
Oh, he's over 300.
Yeah, but how are you surprised that Drew Onyx, over 300 pounds, hits hard? Of course he hits hard. He's a huge dude.
Because it was the first statement of, like, oh, we'll have an easy match. That's why it threw me off. Like,
well, you chopped him first.
I know, but I guess, like, he realized when I said, like, oh, let's not make it easy, he actually decided, okay, it's not going to be easy.
So how many chops did he hit you with?
Not that many, actually. Probably, like, 6.
You could have taken more. How many could you have taken?
Well, the thing is, like, I was the face, right? And his mentality was, like, he's going to give me some, but then I have to get the over, usually. And that's just the way that kind of worked. And, you know, don't worry. He got me.
Yeah.
He got me very good, so.
Good.
Don't worry about that.
Good.
I wanted to, like, put his shirt over his head and make it look like I was going to chop him. But he's like, this isn't a hockey fight. You know, I'm not some jabroni. You're not going to treat me like garbage. So it was good, though. I kind of did that, like, intentionally. I wanted to get him, like, riled up. But I didn't realize, and I should have, that by riling him up, he was going to bring it quite heavily to me. But that was just a lot of fun wrestling him. It's just so easy.
And you beat him.
By count out, because we did this thing where we're both on the outside chopping each other, and it got up to an 8 count, and we look at each other, and we go to slide in, but he decides not to slide in, and he gets on the mic afterwards saying, like, I have nothing to prove against you, I'm still a tag team champion, and I'll just worry about Saturday, because we have a tag team match this Saturday, so, and that's it. I told him, come on, you guys both get in the ring. It was two of them, my partner wasn't there. Tell him, get in the ring. Like, come on. Like, you want to face us 2-on-1? Fine. Step back. They go to charge, and then they just walk away to the dressing room.
Wow.
Yeah.
Johnny Norris standing tall at the end of the show?
Yeah, he made me look like $1 million.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. That's amazing. That's a good spot for you. Main event, closing the show. Roman Reignsing it. Standing there with two guys, and they don't want any piece of you. They're backing away, and you're just standing in the ring like, bring it. Look at you, Roman Reigns.
Originally, I was supposed to do a promo, too, after the match, and thankfully.
Hoo-ah!
But they canned that because there was a little bit too much talking, so they canned that. I'm glad they did because during the match, I did this thing where I'm supposed to, like, give Drew Onyx, like, a power slam. And, again, I underestimated him. He jumped quite a bit. So much that he's up there, and then I'm like, wow, you're up there, and then I got to drop him down. So he pretty much comes down, like, with all his force, and it just sucked the wind completely out of me. Like, just kicking out of that was the hardest thing.
Of his power slam?
Well, of my attempted power slam / he just, like, collapses on me kind of thing.
So you attempt the power slam, and he just goes down on you?
Yeah.
You fall down on him?
Think Hogan Andre, but
yeah.
It didn't work.
It's tough kicking out of that.
Oh, man. But again, I didn't realize he was going to jump that much. I told him, too, like, I'm glad that was near the finish because I was dead after.
And, yeah, you're going to wrestle him again, and I'll be there.
Yeah, this Saturday. I mean, you know, we just started the war, and now this Saturday comes to an end.
The Great War. The Great War is already over, John. I don't know if you heard.
I saw.
Yeah, I mean, Bray Wyatt's in the lake of reincarnation. He ain't never coming back.
You hope.
He'll probably come back. Maybe reincarnated, though. Yes. It was wonderful.
I saw. I enjoyed it.
Wonderful. What a wonderful week in the WWE. Truly wonderful. How about Matt Hardy, Woken Matt Hardy, versus Daniel Bryan? That's now possible. That would be fun. How about, like, Daniel Bryan in the Ultimate Yes Deletion? That would be pretty awesome. Daniel Bryan at the Hardy Compound? That would be crazy. Possibilities are endless.
They are, but it doesn't make sense right now for that to happen.
It'd be cool, though.
There's other options, I think, on the table.
There are so many options on the table. That's one of them.
I think it's really on the depth chart, that one. But
Daniel Bryan ever wrestled Jeff Hardy?
I think so. I feel like he did.
When?
It's a great question.
I don't know if it's ever happened.
Yeah, maybe not.
I'd like to see that.
Because, yeah, Jeff left in 2009.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I guess they didn't wrestle.
I feel like they've never wrestled each other. Like, maybe never, ever.
Yeah, probably not.
Because people are like, oh, AJ Styles, Daniel Bryan. But that happened in, like, Ring of Honor or whatever. I don't think Jeff Hardy ever wrestled Daniel Bryan. Like, ever.
Yeah, but, like, the wrestlers they were in 2005, 2006, they're completely different now. So that's why you'd want to see it again. It's like,
yeah,
we have this back then. What's going to be like now?
Not saying I don't want to see it. I definitely want to see it.
Things with Jeff. Jeff hasn't wrestled in a while, too. Like, how is Jeff going to be?
I don't know.
It's cool we saw Jeff, but...
Yeah, is Jeff even going to come back? Because he's got that arrest deal he's got to work out. He's got problems with the law.
He's always got problems, so... Jeff really needs to get his act together, you
know?
The
demons. They're called demons, John. In the wrestling world, we call them demons. Should I get to the New Japan Cup a little bit?
You should.
So, Zack Sabre Jr. won the cup on my podcast, the New Japan Cup podcast that I did. I did predict Zack Sabre Jr. to win the whole thing after he beat Naito in the first round. It seemed like they were pushing him pretty strong, and he wound up beating Kota Ibushi by ref stoppage in a pretty good match in the quarterfinals, then beating Sonata by submission in the semifinals before finally submitting Hiroshi Tanahashi in the finals. And now Zack Sabre Jr. is going to move on to Sakura Genesis, taking place on March 30th. No, wait. Sorry about that. April 1st. It's a Road to Sakura Genesis show that's going on March 30th. But it's Sakura Genesis in Tokyo on April 1st, so about a week before WrestleMania. And it will be Zack Sabre Jr. challenging Kazuchika Okada for the IWGP Heavyweight Championship. Pretty impressive run for Zack Sabre Jr. through the tournament, beating Tetsuya Naito, Kota Ibushi, Sanada, and Hiroshi Tanahashi. Four of the top stars in all of New Japan Wrestling going down to the Englishman, ZSJ, the submission specialist, really bringing the new breed of submission grappling into professional wrestling. He really has a style that is unique, and he's taken a lot of things that are cutting edge in the world of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and submission grappling, and he's transferring those moves into professional wrestling. Very similar to what he did there with Tanahashi. That's a Eddie Bravo style move. He had him in a truck, got him with a wishbone, splitting his legs apart, and just tearing his groin. And that's how Tanahashi tapped out. It's really high level grappling translated very nicely to pro wrestling. He makes it artistic looking. He makes it fancy. Zack Sabre Jr. has really developed this style, and he's getting a massive push now in New Japan, and I wonder how far it's going to go. I could see him ending the ridiculously long reign, couple of years now, of Kazuchika Okada as IWGP Heavyweight Champion. I mean, you look at what Zack Sabre Jr. did throughout this tournament, having some great matches and beating the top guys in the company. Naito, Ibushi, Sanada, Tanahashi. It doesn't get bigger than those guys in New Japan. The only guy missing, the only guy left to really take on, is Okada.
Well, like you said, given the names that he'd beaten, like, it'd be surprising if he didn't become champion. And if he doesn't win the championship, why give him this? It would just kind of be a waste almost.
Well, it does make him into a main event player, and it does kind of showcase him, but I agree with you. I think that giving him the title at this point makes a lot of sense because Okada has kind of run out of opponents. He's beat everybody. He's been champion for so long that you kind of got to move it forward and change it up a little bit. Make new stars. make Zack Sabre Jr. into a bigger star. He's a great talent, and he's cutting some excellent promos. There was a press conference that the New Japan did for the New Japan Cup, and he cut this long promo. He's getting asked questions, and it was really good stuff from Zack Sabre Jr. The guy can talk. The guy can wrestle. He's got a good look. He's tall. Maybe lacks a little bit of size, you know, of musculature. He could add maybe 10, 15 pounds on his body. But I think with age, the guy is quite young. And I believe that as he gets older, he will add some of that weight. How old is Zack Sabre Jr.? Oh, he's only 30. Man, he's 30 years old. I thought he was younger than that. Yeah, what's the deal, man? He needs to add some weight to his body. 30 years old, you should be a little bit bigger than that. Like, he's not huge, you know? And that's the one thing that I see him, and I'm like, yeah. But he makes his style quite believable. I don't want to take anything away from the guy. He's tremendous. He's a tremendous talent. But he is quite skinny for a pro wrestler. You know, it stands out.
I think in Japan, I don't think it's going to be that big of a deal.
No.
In WWE, it'd be a huge deal. And well, that's probably why he wasn't signed.
WWE, I think they wanted to sign him, but I think they wanted to sign him to be on, like, 205 Live.
Yeah, that probably was very appealing for him. I mean, look what he got instead.
What would you rather do as a pro wrestler? Be on 205 Live, where you're in the WWE, you know, but you're not really. Or you win the New Japan Cup, and you get the headline Sakura Genesis against Kazuchika Okada. Win or lose, it's a pretty sweet spot. And he might win.
Yeah, it's obviously the New Japan offer is good. I mean, I'm not saying 205 is a bad offer. There are worse options out there, but yeah, New Japan is the best one.
And I think he might win, but then again, he's facing Okada, so he might not.
Even still, the fact that he won something like this and beat those kind of guys, regardless if he beats Okada or not, I could see him being a champion in the future.
Yeah, and I wouldn't mind seeing him become the champion now. He would become the first ever British-born IWGP champion, heavyweight champion.
Well, foreigners have won the championship before.
Yeah, but not from England.
Not from England. Be cool if he got to be the first guy.
I'm looking forward to it. Should be a great match with Okada. I think also on that card, we're going to have Tetsuya Naito against Minoru Suzuki for the Intercontinental title, which will be ridiculous. And as much as Okada and Sabre Jr. is going to be good, Naito and Suzuki is the match I really want to see. We've seen a lot of interactions throughout the tour for the New Japan Cup. You know, on the undercard, we have a lot of these matches, and they're tag team matches. Mm-hmm. A lot of members of, Suzuki Gun against Los Ingobernables. Suzuki and Naito have had a lot of interactions in the ring against each other, and they're teasing something. Like, it's going to happen. Suzuki's really frustrated by Naito's tranquilo style. Like, Naito kind of, like, everybody, when they wrestle Suzuki, they kind of look at him, and they're scared, and they show him respect, and they're staring at him as he comes to the ring. Naito, he doesn't even look at him. Huh. He just kind of sits there in the ring and just kind of looks off into the distance. And Suzuki's like staring at him, and Naito will never even look him in the face. And Suzuki's just getting so frustrated. He's so angered by Naito. He goes in the ring to wrestle him like they're both tagged in, and Naito just kind of acts like he's about to wrestle him and then tags out. Like he's messing with Suzuki and he's frustrating him. So Suzuki, to get a piece of Naito so that he can get his hands on him, he's willing to put his Intercontinental title on the line just to lure Naito into a match. So I think that match is going to happen at Genesis. It's not official yet, but oh my goodness. That's going to be good.
Surprised it's not official? We're only like 2 weeks away?
Yeah, like they have two matches official so far. I don't know what they're waiting for. I think maybe after this show that they're doing here coming up, the Strong Style Evolved, which is in California. Like, they're in California now. They're doing a show in Long Beach, California.
With no Rey.
No Rey Mysterio. Yeah, he was supposed to be on the card. And this is Sunday night. It should be good. but no Ray. He was supposed to wrestle Jushin Thunder Liger, but he's got an arm injury. So Will Ospreay is going to replace him to wrestle Liger. Disappointing.
It's too bad. I mean, are they going to reschedule the match? Or are you still going to get it one day eventually?
Well, from what I understand, Ray's about to sign with the WWE. So, you know?
Well, that sucks.
Maybe not.
It's really a shame if he doesn't get that. I mean, I know it's happened before, but again, it's cool to see a match that happened many years ago and to see it now.
Yeah, I would like to see it again, but... You know, Ray's hurt. What are you going to do? And is he going to the WWE? I could see him appearing on Raw after Mania. I think that's when we're going to see Rey Mysterio. Don't you? Doesn't that make a lot of sense? Like, right now, Mania is pretty well booked. He's not going to be at Mania, but he'll be on the Raw after Mania. We need some surprises. We need some returns. We need something. Rey Mysterio.
Well, if
we can't just get Big Cass, right? Big Cass can't be the Raw after Mania surprise.
If he has a torn bicep, you're not going to see him for like 6 months.
Oh, man. So maybe not. Maybe just Big Cass. Maybe Enzo Amore. Imagine that.
Yeah, I wish. I don't think so.
Do you wish?
Yeah. Enzo was awesome to watch, actually.
I think those charges are going to get cleared up pretty soon.
He's still like fired, though. It doesn't change anything.
Yeah, well, they could rehire him if he didn't do anything. He was accused of rape. If the lady accusing him of rape is lying, which a lot of people are accusing her of lying, still on the internet people are accusing her of lying. If she is lying, shouldn't Enzo get his job back?
I believe the issue is the fact that he didn't tell them that this was coming up.
All right, but I mean, come on. When's the last time you saw a cruiserweight on Raw? Are you watching did you watch the tournament?
I know that it's supposed to be Cedric Alexander. I believe it's going to be wrestling against Mustafa Ali.
That's the final for the title at WrestleMania?
I think so.
Ouch.
Or Drew Gulak, maybe.
Oh, double ouch. Yeah, you're right. It's Cedric Alexander versus Mustafa Ali to determine a new cruiserweight champion. We're back where we started with the cruiserweight division. Nowhere. No Enzo. Bring back Enzo. Seriously. Like, as soon as he gets this cleared up, I don't think he did anything. Okay? It doesn't seem like he did anything. He's not in jail. There's no charges. It's not like things are happening with Enzo. So, like, as soon as it's over, can they just bring him back and give him the title back?
Did they bring back Rich Swann?
No.
Charges were dropped there.
There you go. Maybe he didn't want to come back. Who knows? Who knows what happened? Could we bring Neville back? Where's Neville? Is he, like, he's not wrestling anywhere either. Is he still under contract? What's his deal?
I think that's the issue, that he's still under contract. And I don't think he wants to be on 205. I can't blame him. He's definitely above that, but they want him there.
I miss the king of the cruiserweights.
Yeah, I'm sure he doesn't miss that.
Yeah. Okay, so this Strong Style Evolved card, it's main evented by the Golden Lovers, Kota Ibushi and Kenny Omega, finally reunited. Ibushi was teaming with Chase Owens a lot on this New Japan tour. Omega wasn't on it. So Ibushi teaming with some Bullet Club guys. We have a little bit of like Bullet Club implosion here on this card as Ibushi and Omega... taking on the Young Bucks in the main event. It could be match of the year right there. Should be ridiculous. Jay White defending his IWGP US title against Hangman Page. Minoru Suzuki and Zack Sabre Jr. teaming up to take on Kazuchika Okada and Tomohiro Ishii. That match should be fantastic. As we mentioned, Jushin Thunder Liger taking on Will Ospreay. Los Ingobernables de Japón, Tetsuya Naito, Sanada, Bushi, and Hiromu Takahashi. They face off against Hiroshi Tanahashi, Kushida, Taguchi, and Dragon Lee. Then we have another Bullet Club on Bullet Club match. Kind of surprised about this one, actually. Cody and Marty Scurll. Teaming up to take on Tama Tonga and Tonga Loa. I thought Tama Tonga was hurt. I'm kind of surprised he's working this match because he wasn't working the New Japan Tour at all. But that should be a real interesting match. I mean, I didn't know there was beef between those guys, but I guess Tangaloa and Tama Tonga are on Team Kenny and Marty Scurll and, of course, Cody on Team Cody.
So this really is like the NWO White versus NWO Wolfpack now?
Yeah, it's Team Kenny versus Team Cody. This card is really doing it more than any other cards that we've seen so far in New Japan.
Well, it seems like it's a slow build towards them completely feuding, but...
Well, they do have a match booked for a Ring of Honor card, Cody versus Kenny.
Finally.
WrestleMania weekend. That's been booked for a long time. That's... It's called Super Card of Honor.
Sounds about right.
WrestleMania weekend in New Orleans, like all the indie shows do shows WrestleMania weekend.
Right.
Because all the wrestling fans are there. And that's going to be one of the matches. That could be match of the weekend right there. Cody versus Kenny might be better than anything at WrestleMania. You've got Davey Boy Smith Jr. and Lance Archer. The Killer Elite Squad. They take on Toru Yano and Chucky T. Chucky T's been really impressing me on this tour in New Japan. He's a very good wrestler. He's a lot of fun to watch. I'm a Chucky T fan. I like Toru Yano as well. David Finlay and Juice Robinson, they're teaming up to take on Goto and Gato. And then you have, wow, this is interesting. A little bit of Ring of Honor versus New Japan action where you have the Fallen Angel, Christopher Daniels, Frankie Kazarian and Scorpio Sky, they team up to face Rocky Romero, Sho, and Yo, Roppongi 3K. And that's the opening match. That's a great card.
I didn't realize Daniels and Kazarian were in Japan, but that's cool.
Well, they're not in Japan. They're in California. This is a special show, right? They do a lot of stuff crossover with Ring of Honor. And I guess, I mean, these guys, they did Honor Rising, right, in Japan about a month ago-ish, which was a lot of the Ring of Honor guys coming over to Japan, but Daniels and Kazarian weren't there. But I guess they're doing a show in California. They were available, and here we go. Daniels, Kazarian, and Scorpio Sky. Who's Scorpio Sky? I don't know him. He's not a New Japan guy. He must be a Ring of Honor guy or something.
They probably remind him of Too Cool Scorpio. That's probably how he got the name.
Maybe. I don't know. Should be good, though, man. That one going down Sunday night. In California, live on New Japan World, newjapanworld.com.
There's always wrestling going on somewhere.
Yeah, man. No WWE pay-per-view this Sunday. Forget that. Watch Strong Style Evolved. Okada is in North America right now. The man, the top wrestler in the game. Or is he? Because Daniel Bryan's back. So, the game has changed. The game is fully changed. Should we get into it?
Triple H would approve. The game has changed.
The game has changed. I'm always changing. I used to have long hair, and now I have short hair. I used to wear a leather jacket, and now I wear a suit.
Always has the most coolest entrance in WrestleMania.
I have the coolest entrance in WrestleMania. Remember when my wife Stephanie dressed up like China?
Yeah, that was weird.
That was weird. Remember that? Was that last year?
I think last year was Mad Max. Because they were on the bike last year, no?
Was that the one where Stephanie cut that promo?
I think so.
That was terrible. No more of that. They do weirdo stuff for WrestleMania. They're fulfilling some sort of weirdo fantasies they have, I think, involving leather and medieval masks.
I think she was China against Roman Reigns, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. Who did he work last year?
Seth.
Oh, yeah. Forgettable. This one's going to be a lot more impressive. Stephanie actually has to wrestle here against Ronda Rousey. That could be rough. It was rough for Dana Brooke. Ouch.
Yeah, I saw it, but again, like, no one's going to say anything. Like, fine, the throw looked kind of sloppy, or it looked dangerous, but no one's going to say anything if Ronda does something like that.
What are you going to do?
Exactly.
She's the new Brock. Lady Brock.
I don't understand the point of this. I guess just for the crowd, I suppose, there. Because they said they were going to have Ronda at Raw, but I guess it doesn't have to be live. Because it doesn't seem like they have anything more towards the storyline. They're pretty much set up to Mania. Maybe the last Raw, but that's about it, it seems.
That video package was real good this week.
And Kurt talks about it here and there. That's nice, fine. But it doesn't seem like the interest is there as much as it was when this first started. When it first started, it felt like that was the only WrestleMania match.
Yeah, well, they've done the build for it already.
Well, you can do more, actually. They're getting lazy with it, but...
Well, we're still, what, 2 weeks out? You got two more shows to do something.
She'll be there, just in another dark segment. It's stupid.
Is that what she's doing?
I imagine.
She might be on TV.
I think they're worried about her, actually. I don't think they want to use her, like, over-showcase her, I guess, because something like that could happen where it's like, ugh, that looked kind of rough.
Wasn't a great segment. If that was on TV, we'd be like, eh, that wasn't that good.
It wouldn't have made sense because it felt like Dana, like, she's doing the gimmick with Titus and she went back to her old gimmick there.
Yeah. Didn't make sense. Okay, let's do this thing. 3, 2, 1.
Hello, this is Mick Foley and you are listening to Wrestling Uncensored.
Hey, this is the Heartbreak Kid, Shawn Michaels, and you are listening to Wrestling Uncensored.
What's going on, y'all? This is WWE Superstar Kofi Kingston, and you're listening to Wrestling Uncensored.
Yeah. Welcome to Wrestling Uncensored. I am Dave Simon. He is Johnny North. WrestlingUncensored.net is our website. And, of course, every Saturday night right here on TSN 690. We just did the world-famous Wrestling Uncensored pre-show, a super long edition. We can't fit everything in the world of professional wrestling on this one-hour time block that we have on TSN 690, so we have to extend it, and it's available for download right now at WrestlingUncensored.net. You can download the show, subscribe on iTunes, on Google Play, wherever you get your podcasts. We're on YouTube as well. Check out our YouTube channel. YouTube.com/ringsidereport.net with the .net spelled out, D-O-T-N-E-T. We're everywhere. Every show is available on YouTube. That's a new thing, Johnny North. How about that? We're on YouTube now. We're expanding. We're everywhere. WrestlingUncensored.net is the place to go for all the information. Check us out right there. We just got done talking about New Japan professional wrestling. The New Japan Cup happened. Zack Sabre Jr. won. He's going to take on Okada for the heavyweight title coming up. We discussed that. And the New Japan show in California taking place tomorrow night. We previewed that show as well. So much going on in the world of professional wrestling, not just in the WWE, but all over the world. Even right here in our own backyard, as Johnny North had 4 matches last weekend. And we talked about all of those matches. Some pretty exciting stuff in the world of Johnny North. He's got matches happening all over the place, and we'll tell you a little bit later on when you can see him wrestle next near you. But right now, WrestleMania is 2 weeks away. We should probably get to that, right? WrestleMania 34 is 2 weeks away, and this week, the big news, we found out, finally, our prayers have been answered. Daniel Bryan has been medically cleared to return to the ring. I'm going to say that again because it feels so good. Daniel Bryan has been medically cleared to return to the ring. And if you saw SmackDown this week, you know that's no work. That's for real. That's the truth. Daniel Bryan was physical in a WWE ring this week for the first time in over 2 years. He's been out. He's had concussion problems, post-concussion problems. Before that, he was having some neck issues that kept him out for a while. And now, when it seemed like his career in the WWE was likely over, they have cleared him to compete. And he's back. And he was in there with Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens this week. Who better to welcome him back into some physical action? Who better than Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens? Bryan throwing some kicks and taking a beating as well. Got hit at the end of SmackDown with the Kevin Owens powerbomb on the apron. That has taken many guys, including Sami Zayn, taking him out for many, many weeks afterwards. Daniel Bryan, I expect, will team up with Shane McMahon at WrestleMania to take on Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens this year. And, you know, I think the WrestleMania card was looking pretty good before this week. But the fact that we have Daniel Bryan back, and he'll likely be wrestling at Mania, not only improves this card, not only improves the WWE moving forward, but it improves the whole business of professional wrestling. This changes the game. This is Daniel Bryan. This is one of the greatest wrestlers of all time. And he's getting a second act here. I don't know how often he's going to be wrestling in the WWE. I don't know what his schedule's going to be. But I gotta believe that Bryan wants to wrestle as much as possible because he loves to wrestle. That's what this whole thing's been about. Coming back because he loves wrestling. And now he gets to do it. I'm so happy for him. I'm so happy for us because we get to see him wrestle again. And the WWE now has completely changed. The game has changed because Daniel Bryan is one of the biggest stars that this company has ever had. He's one of the greatest wrestlers in the history of the business. And we thought his career was over. And now it's not. He's back. This is like saying, oh, you know what, Steve Austin? Yeah, he's not so hurt. He's back. He's good to go. What do you mean? Yeah, Austin, he's going to work Mania this year and he can wrestle as much as he want. What, really? Yeah. It's fine. It's like bringing back a legend. And what this really feels like to me is Shawn Michaels. When Shawn left wrestling because his back was hurt, he was gone for 4 years. And he was done. After WrestleMania 14, when he dropped the title to Steve Austin, Shawn Michaels had a career-ending back injury and was retiring and was never going to wrestle again. 4 years later, he's starting to feel better. He's rested. He's better. He's cleaned himself up. And he starts wrestling again. And he wrestles for several more years. And has an incredible run. And is now remembered as one of the greatest wrestlers of all time. And this feels very much like Shawn Michaels coming back. Because with Shawn, you thought, he's done. It's over. It's too bad. He's one of the best ever. And then a few years later, he comes back. Brand new career, and all of a sudden you have all these years of Shawn Michaels you never expected you would have. You have all these classic matches that at one point in time seemed impossible. You know, when Shawn retired after WrestleMania 14, you didn't think he'd have those great matches with The Undertaker or Ric Flair or all the amazing stuff that he did post, what, 2002 when he came back?
He pretty much came back mid-2002, if I'm not mistaken. SummerSlam 2002. But he had one match with Triple H. And then I think maybe he wrestled once or twice in like tags or something.
Even then, they weren't sure if he was going to come back full-time.
I think it was after Elimination Chamber when they gave him the championship. Then he practically was full-time. And then up until the first match with Taker, then he was more part-time and then retired. So baby steps, I think, with Daniel Bryan. Let's not rush this. One match, and let's see what happens with that.
Well, I think that's what they're going to do. They're going to keep testing him, from what I understand, for the time being. You know, after every physical interaction, they're going to, you know, make sure he's all right and keep a close eye on him, because it's still a wait-and-see type of deal with Daniel Bryan, because for a long time, he was not medically cleared by the WWE, and now he is. So you got to be careful with a guy like that. But maybe he's been able to heal. Maybe he is better. And maybe we're going to have many more years and many more matches with one of the greatest to ever do it, a future Hall of Famer. This guy's going to the Hall of Fame now, without a doubt. Can you imagine what he's going to do over the next few years if he can stay healthy?
I'm just concerned. I'm very concerned how things are going to play out because of what we've seen in the past with Daniel Bryan, where they gave him the ball. He pretty much was the top star in WWE, and they overworked him. He wrestled like two or three times a night on Raw and SmackDown. It was too much. They burnt him out. I'm not surprised he got injured. And the problem is he got injured, and then he got injured again. That's very worrisome.
I don't think they're going to use him as much as they did this time around. I think that's a pretty safe bet because they did work him like a dog when he was their guy.
I'm still worried that the first time we see him back in the ring, he takes a beating.
He already did.
I don't like that. That's not a good first start.
Well, you got to test him out and see if he can take that beating, right? And I think with Sammy and Kevin, two guys that can give him a safe beating. Two guys that he knows, that he's comfortable with, that he's friends with, that he trusts to test him out and see what he can do. And you know Sammy and Kevin didn't want to hurt Daniel Bryan. You know that they're so excited to see him back in the ring because they know, man, we got to keep this guy safe because we could draw some major money in matches with this guy. Because Sammy and Kevin, they probably never thought that they'd be able to have a match with Daniel Bryan. Up until, you know, recently, Daniel Bryan was retired. And I'm sure Sammy and Kevin didn't expect that they'd be wrestling Shane McMahon and Daniel Bryan at this year's WrestleMania. But I really think that's going to happen. It's incredible. And, of course, you got to be careful with Bryan, and who knows how often he's going to wrestle or what they're going to do. I know a lot of people on Twitter right away were telling me, hey, he should replace Roman Reigns and face Brock Lesnar. He should be Universal Champion.
Huh.
I say, stop the clock on that one. Just whoa, whoa, whoa. Slow down. Because, you know, that's a bit much for Bryan's first match. Brock Lesnar doesn't care about you. Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens care about Daniel Bryan. Brock Lesnar does not. You might call him careless in the ring. Brock will toss you around, he'll dump you on your head, and he will not care about it. So, Daniel Bryan and Brock Lesnar is not the match I want to see because Brock might hurt him. Legitimately. He might hurt him. I don't want to see that. I don't need to see that. Not yet, anyways. Let me see that Bryan is okay, that Bryan can wrestle Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn and AJ Styles and Shinsuke Nakamura and, who else? There's so many guys, right? Not Braun Strowman. Stay away from Braun Strowman. I know they said that they had a thing with Dolph Ziggler this week on SmackDown. Ziggler's like, I look forward to beating you or whatever. And Bryan's like, yeah, we'll see about that. I don't want to see that. I don't need to see Bryan versus Ziggler. I don't need to see Bryan versus The Miz either. I know a lot of people were telling me on Twitter, at Dave Simon MMA, by the way, The Miz and Bryan, they have that heat thing. They should do the match. I'm like, yeah, do the match, but it's 2 minutes. Bryan goes over really strong. I don't want to see a long feud between those two because Daniel Bryan, he may have a few matches. Who knows, you know? We know that at one point it was a limited number of matches that he could have in his career. So now who knows how many matches you're going to get. And I don't want to waste a Daniel Bryan match on The Miz. Unless it's real short and Bryan takes no punishment. But the match is there. I mean, Kurt Angle? Kurt Angle versus Daniel Bryan? Dream match? There's a lot of cool matches out there for Daniel Bryan. Daniel Bryan versus Woken Matt Hardy at the Hardy Compound. There's a lot of fun stuff you could do with D-Bry. We were talking about it on the pre-show, Daniel Bryan versus Jeff Hardy. I don't think that match has ever happened. I'd like to see it. Just give it to me as a main event of Raw. I'll watch that.
Well, before we talk about dream matches, this tag match you're talking about of Shane McMahon, Daniel Bryan against Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn, that's not official yet. Right now, Kevin and Sammy, they're fired in the storylines.
Yes, Daniel Bryan fired them for what they did to Shane McMahon the week prior, and then they beat up Daniel Bryan. Well, what do you think is going to happen? The one week they beat up Shane McMahon together. The next week they beat up Daniel Bryan together. They're fired, but, I mean, you know, they're not fired. So they're going to wrestle them in a tag team match. What do you think is going to happen? Really, John? It's not official. Come on, man. What are you talking about?
I'm just saying, like, you talk about the match is going to happen. I mean, you don't know for 100% sure this match is going to happen. Maybe it might be different. Maybe they'll throw Dolph Ziggler in there. Maybe they'll throw Baron Corbin in there.
What?
Make it a six-man. They could
no,
do that.
No, listen, you need guys for the Andre the Giant Battle Royal, okay? That's where those two jabronis are going.
I'm just saying it's not impossible because it's not 100% that we're getting this tag match.
So what do you think is going to happen? I'm going to bet. You want to put money down that this is the match that's going to happen? Do you?
I don't want
to. Do you want to bet against it, John?
No, but it's not impossible that they throw in Baron Corbin and Dolph Ziggler.
I think it is. I think it's pretty well impossible. Baron Corbin? Tom Peacestock? That's his real name, by the way. I see why they call him Baron Corbin. Coming to the ring, Tom Peacestock, the Lone Wolf. Doesn't have a great ring to it.
Doesn't Dolph deserve more than just the Andre the Giant Battle Royal match?
No.
I think some people disagree with you on that one.
So? So what?
It's a little ridiculous. He hasn't had really a WrestleMania moment yet in his career, and he's been there for so long. It's too bad. He's a great talent.
So what do you want to see Dolph Ziggler do this year, John? How about he replaces Nakamura, and it's Ziggler versus AJ Styles for the title? How about that? Would you be happy there? How about this? You know where Dolph Ziggler should go? In the Jabroni match with Randy and Bobby Roode and Jinder Mahal. Go for the U.S. title. Make it a fatal four-way. That match is official, by the way. You must be real excited. Randy Orton defending the U.S. title against Bobby Roode and Jinder Mahal, the modern-day Maharaja. Wow. That's the bathroom break of the show. Snack break, bathroom break, smoke break, whatever you want to do. It's break time during that match. Every other match on the card looks pretty incredible. Let me just explain to you who is on this card, just in case you forgot. Let me list some names of people that are wrestling at WrestleMania right now. Brock Lesnar, Daniel Bryan, AJ Styles, Shinsuke Nakamura, Ronda Rousey, Kurt Angle, Kevin Owens, Sami Zayn, Asuka. Is that an incredible list or what? I mean, this card could go down as one of the greatest WrestleMania cards in the history of the business, and Roman Reigns is a big part of it somehow. I mean, he's on the card. He's not a big part of why the card is going to be so great, but he is a part of, you know, he's a big part of the WWE. Like, he's the centerpiece of the show. Even though everybody else I mentioned, you know, far more interesting. AJ versus Nakamura, Daniel Bryan's in-ring return, Ronda Rousey's in-ring debut, Kurt Angle, the Olympic hero wrestling, teaming up with Ronda against Triple H, the game, and Stephanie McMahon. Brock Lesnar will be there against Roman Reigns, but Brock Lesnar will be there. It's pretty cool. It's a pretty cool Mania right now. I'm excited. Like, you know, people could be mad as they want about Roman Reigns beating Brock and Roman being the guy and da-da-da, but Daniel Bryan's back. Daniel Bryan's going to wrestle on this thing. Ronda Rousey's going to debut on this thing. AJ Styles is going to wrestle Nakamura for the WWE Championship on this card. It's a pretty exciting WrestleMania.
Well, it sounds like it's going to be really long. 5 hours for sure, without question.
Johnny North, a little bit of glass half full?
A little bit.
Can we? You're doing glass half empty over there. I'm happy with this. You can't be negative on a week where Daniel Bryan's making his comeback. Yes, yes, yes. Not no, no, no.
I was telling you that so I teach your son to do the no chance. That'd be great for you growing up, I'm sure.
Uh-huh.
I'm just fearful that, yes, like, a lot of these matches, they seem appealing, but let's face it, it's not the same Kurt Angle that we saw when he first debuted. You know, Triple H was never the best wrestler. It's not going to get much better.
Look, Triple H has had some great matches.
Not many.
His matches with Cactus Jack were great. Okay.
Fine.
You'll admit that, at least. They were great. His Royal Rumble match with Mick Foley was one of the greatest matches in WWE history.
18 years ago.
Well, so he still did it. He's like 45 years old. What do you want him to do? Still have great matches?
Just saying, like, you look at name value and, like, yeah, okay, you have great names. You know, you have The Undertaker. You're not going to get the best Undertaker match.
Well, John, The Undertaker's not official. Do you really think Undertaker's going to show up? It might be John Cena versus Baron Corbin and Dolph Ziggler.
Actually, I think John Cena versus Kane's a stronger possibility, given off what we just saw on Raw.
You'd love that, too.
I think Kane deserves a WrestleMania appearance.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so does Dolph Ziggler. Why don't they wrestle each other? Everybody in your mind deserves a WrestleMania appearance. Kane, Dolph Ziggler, Baron Corbin for some reason.
Well, Baron Corbin has the best like music in WWE. There's no question about that.
How about John Cena?
No, John Cena. It's good because the fans made it great.
I don't think Baron Corbin has the best music in WWE. How about... I don't know. Asuka's theme is good. I like Asuka's music.
It's okay, but it's no Baron Corbin song.
Okay. I didn't know you liked Baron Corbin's song so much.
That's amazing.
I'll play it on the show just for you.
Jim Johnson's last song before he left WWE.
Was it?
Yeah. I think that's what makes it so special.
But this card, I don't know, man. I'm very excited about it. I think it's got the possibility of being one of the best cards in the history of WrestleMania, at least on paper. And, you know, you talk about Triple H and Kurt Angle and that match, and Stephanie, okay, she's not a wrestler. Kurt Angle, he's not the same as he used to be. That's true. Triple H is not the same. But they're going to give their maximum effort because it's WrestleMania. I think Triple H and Kurt Angle both are going to wrestle like it's their last match ever, right? Like, they are going to give it their all. My one concern is how Ronda and Stephanie are going to interact. Because Stephanie's not Asuka in there, you know? She's not a great wrestler.
She's not bad.
She's not bad, but she's not great. So, you know, I feel like you might need a great wrestler to make Ronda look good. So I don't know how good Ronda's going to look in there with Stephanie McMahon. But that's really what everybody's watching that match for. Triple H and Kurt Angle, as you would put it, John, that's just the salad dressing, brother. Right? The real attraction to that match is Ronda Rousey in a ring doing more than one move at a time. What have we seen her do? We've seen her throw Triple H through the table, one move. We've seen her pick up Stephanie and hit her with that Samoan drop deal, one move. We saw her this week in a dark segment that aired on YouTube, didn't even air on WWE's Raw TV show, but Ronda was in the building. She comes out, she talks a little bit. It wasn't great. Dana Brooke comes out, makes fun of her for some reason, and then Ronda throws her, and the throw looked pretty rough. Had a lot of comments there, especially from our buddies Andy and Wally. They were commenting to me on Twitter this week about that throw and how terrible it looked there on Dana Brooke, and yeah, it didn't look so good. So it begs the question, well, if she can't hit one move that well, if she's asked to do one move and it doesn't come off looking too good, what happens when she's asked to have an entire match? What happens when she has to put one move together with another move and then another move? Like, what happens when she actually has to wrestle? If these one moves are looking kind of rough, what is her wrestling going to look like? So I'm really interested to see that match for Ronda Rousey. Is it going to be a great success, or is it going to be an immense failure?
Well, expectations are way too high, so if you keep them at this rate, yeah, of course it's going to be a failure because you're expecting the world from her too much, it seems.
I'm not expecting that much from her. I'm saying the moves she's pulling off don't look so good. I'm expecting her to not do so well. So far, in the ring, her moves that she has done have not looked great. The first thing she did to Triple H looked pretty cool, but the move to Stephanie and now the throw on Dana Brooke this week, yeah, not looking too good.
If you look at a lot of wrestlers, a lot of them, some of the moves, like, it's not impressive. You expect the world from Ronda because of who she is. Again, your expectations are way too high. In the match, you just got to keep it simple. And again, you're going to expect, oh, she should have done more than that because of who she is. But I think as long as it's just basic, by the numbers, simple, straightforward, that'll be fine. All she has to do is put the armbar on. That's all she's got to do. And just make it compelling the lead up to it.
I don't think it has to look that good. It just doesn't. It just can't look too bad.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it can't look like, oof. It can't be Botchamania in there.
I agree.
She doesn't have to be Daniel Bryan, you know? She can have a very simple little outing. She doesn't have to be an incredible wrestler, especially first time out. But it can't be so bad where you're like, wow, she's never going to get it. It's got to be a point where you're like, okay, there's something there, but she can't be so bad where, you know, because if she's that bad, then the future is bleak as far as her wrestling career.
You know who she's got to be? Randy Orton.
Yeah, not that good, but not that bad, somewhere in the middle. Pretty bland, pretty safe, doesn't do very much, maybe even lazy, but yeah. Randy Orton is pretty accurate, John. If she could be as good as Randy Orton in her first try, I think that'd be okay. She'd have to improve, though, because just Randy Orton level doesn't cut the mustard.
Randy doesn't botch.
No, because he doesn't do anything. And sometimes he does botch.
Sometimes it can be a little complicated for Jinder Mahal, unfortunately.
Yeah. Jinder is hanging there on the ropes, getting ready for the DDT. But Jinder just drops before Randy drops. For some reason. Yeah. Yeah. It's easy to not screw up when all you do is kick and punch. I mean, Randy, you know, when you do very little, it's hard to screw that up. Like, I could say, hey, look, John, I'm going to sit here on the couch. I didn't screw that up, right? No. Now I'm going to do a double backflip, cartwheel, into a little dance. I'll screw that up because I'm trying it. You know what I'm saying? Randy Orton can say, I'm going to give you a headlock. Oh, perfect. No problem. Okay, then I'm going to give you a Hurricane Rana into a 450. Well, you're going to screw that up, Randy. Yeah, okay, I better not try it. When other guys could do Hurricane Ranas into 450s and actually pull it off.
I'm just saying, Randy's philosophy, I think, would work wonders for Ronda.
Keep it simple. Stupid. It's a phrase. I'm not saying anybody's stupid. Certainly not saying Randy's stupid.
I hope not.
No. I would never say that. Only Chris Jericho said that in his book.
He loves him, though.
Yeah. He just says he's not that bright. Said that. In a book. Randy probably didn't read it, though. So.
And he stood up for Randy after Brock, like, beat the crap out of him.
Yeah.
So.
Jericho loves little Randy. That's his man. A lot of guys like Randy. You love Randy.
I think he's cool.
U.S. champion. You think he's going to retain the title?
Oh, it doesn't look like it, unfortunately.
No?
It looks like they're just playing hot potato with the title. Like, they're all going to win the title. And, like, Jinder, for some reason, can beat Randy for titles. It sucks, but it's the way it is.
Yeah, Jinder beats Randy a lot, eh? Jinder cut a promo this week on SmackDown. Then Bobby Roode came out, and he started talking. Then Randy showed up, and then Jinder pushed a Singh brother into Randy and ran away. It's a pretty useless segment.
It's not the most interesting storyline.
It's the least interesting storyline on all of WrestleMania. I'm looking at this card right now, and everything is more interesting than Randy versus Bobby and Jinder. Even The Miz against Rollins and Balor is more interesting. Kind of funny that they're doing a triple threat for the U.S. title. And, you know, that's SmackDown's mid-level title. And then Raw's mid-level title, the Intercontinental title, also a triple threat match.
And the SmackDown tag is also a triple threat, is it not?
The SmackDown tag team title match, I think, is a triple threat. I don't know if that match is actually official yet. Usos versus Bludgeon Brothers versus, what, New Day?
It felt like they alluded to the fact that it's official this week on SmackDown, no?
I don't know if that match is 100% official. It should be, though. I think they're going to do it. We had Luke Harper beating Jimmy Uso this week on SmackDown. I think it's going to be either Bludgeon Brothers versus the Usos or a triple threat. The triple threat would make sense.
Unless it's everyone against the Bludgeon Brothers, but I think that's a little much overkill. But
yeah, I don't know about that one. But yeah, everything's more interesting than Randy versus Bobby versus Jinder. Even Alexa Bliss versus Nia Jax, which was made official this week. See Nia charging after Alexa on Raw? It was kind of funny. Like she decided to stop chasing her, and then she kept chasing her. What was that?
I think probably get her, like, win back, maybe. I don't know. It's a lot to run that far.
Oh, that was a real awkward segment there. It's just so weird with Alexa and Nia. Like, so Asuka wrestles Alexa, right? She beats her by count out when Nia Jax... Alexa just kind of bailed on the match, right?
Well, she had her submission, and she bailed out of the ring.
Yeah, and then Nia Jax showed up to attack Alexa, and then Mickie James tried to stop her for a bit, but then Nia kind of chased after her. She was screaming, and then she started, running after her. And then, like, we go to commercial. We come back. So Nia has chased Alexa backstage. We come back from commercial, and Alexa is in Kurt Angle's office. There's no Nia. Like, what happened? Is Nia not chasing her anymore? Did Nia just give up as soon as they crossed the curtain? It was weird. It didn't make a lot of sense. Like, shouldn't they explain what happened when... Like, how did the chase end? Did Nia just give up?
Or...
And, you know, if Nia sees Alexa's in Kurt Angle's office, shouldn't she go attack her in there? It didn't make a lot of sense.
Maybe officials separated them, so they have to stay apart.
They didn't show us what happened. Anyways, so Angle booked Nia Jax to challenge Alexa for the title at Mania. And I think Nia's probably going to win, right?
It gives her a nice moment. It feels like they've been building this for a long time, and maybe this is the reason why Alexa's had the championship for so long, because Nia was always the person to take the championship away from her.
I suppose.
Who else is there?
Yeah, I don't know. Right now, nobody. Nobody. And as far as the women's battle royal, I don't know if Sasha and Bayley will actually have a one-on-one match at Mania. I think they're going to be thrown in that battle royal, because if you're going to have a women's battle royal, you need people in it.
But it's probably going to come down to the two of them. So that's kind of like their match in a sense.
As it should. One of them should win the first one.
I guess it just feels like it's more than just throw the other person over the top. It feels like there's a bit of a grudge here. And I think you kind of need like a point finale 1-2-3 for this.
I don't know. I don't know if it ends then at WrestleMania. Like, they could do it at whatever, Backlash?
Possibly. Maybe because Bayley hasn't really turned heel yet. I didn't really like her excuse, what she gave to Sasha this week, but...
What did she say exactly? They cut a little promo on Raw this week.
She said, like, I understand what you did, Elimination Chamber, but I don't like what you did, Elimination Chamber.
Oh, because she saw the look in her eye and Sasha was, like, enjoying it too much?
Yeah.
Enjoying hitting Bayley, I guess. And then Sasha and Bayley lost to Mandy Rose and Sonya Deville right after that. They were arguing with each other, which caused the distraction.
I think because there was a pin or something made, or a tag, you know, something like that, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. We got to talk about the final deletion, the ultimate deletion, which happened on Raw this week. And what happened on Raw with The Undertaker and John Cena? Undertaker still not showing up. It was in Texas. and he wasn't there. But there was progress. We got to take a short pause here on TSN 690. WrestleMania is in 2 weeks. It's Wrestling Uncensored.
This is Rob Van Dam. You're listening to Wrestling Uncensored.
This is Santino Varela, and you're listening to Wrestling Uncensored.
This is Curtis Axel, and you're listening to Wrestling Uncensored.
Hey, this is Antonio Cesaro, and you're listening to Wrestling Uncensored.
Hey, this is Trish Stratus, and you're listening to Wrestling Uncensored. Keep listening. Stratisfaction is guaranteed.
Aw, yeah. Welcome back. It is Wrestling Uncensored. I'm Dave Simon. He is Johnny North. Right here on TSN 690 every Saturday night. WrestlingUncensored.net is our website. Download every episode of Wrestling Uncensored, including bonus material that you don't get here on the radio side. The Wrestling Uncensored pre-show, always available at WrestlingUncensored.net. Subscribe on iTunes, on Google Play. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/ringsidereport.net. .net spelled out D-O-T-N-E-T. We're everywhere. You can listen to podcasts, every episode of Wrestling Uncensored. Johnny North, this week on Raw, we saw Braun Strowman defeat Cesaro via pinfall after a power slam. Now, Strowman had cut a promo before that talking about getting a tag team title shot, and he says he's been told that he has to have a partner for WrestleMania. Will it be Elias? Who will Braun Strowman's partner be? Now, we guessed about it a little bit last week, but we weren't sure if Braun was going to be able to face the bar on his own. But now we know it is official. He has to find a partner. Now, not only do I want to know who his partner is going to be, but I wonder if we even find out until the match. I'd like a old-school feel mystery partner where you don't know who's going to show up until WrestleMania. I don't think they should announce it. If it's a cool surprise, save it for a mystery partner. If it's Elias, then tell us as soon as possible because, you know, who cares? Give us a reason why it's Elias and Braun. You know, why is Braun choosing Elias? Elias could make a pitch to Braun, sing a song about him, how awesome he is. Maybe Braun changes his tune on Elias. Get it? Changes his tune. And then decides, hey, okay, maybe we're friends now. I beat you up a lot, but I like your singing, so maybe you're not such a bad guy. Let's sing songs together. We both have beards. We both like to lift weights. We got a lot in common, Elias. Let's be friends. Something like that. I'm not saying it has to go down exactly that way, but something in that way. And, you know, then you give us a reason why they're a tag team. Or, you know, Elias says, hey, Braun, I want to be your tag team partner. I need a spot at WrestleMania. Braun says, no way. Elias says, if I beat you tonight, I get to be your tag team partner. Braun says, fine, you'll never beat me. But Elias winds up beating him by countout or something. So he gets to be his tag team partner, and there you go. There are many ways to go about it, but if you're going to go about it, don't just leave it as, well, Braun's going to have a mystery partner, and then we're at WrestleMania, and we're like, oh, who's it going to be? Is it going to be Rey Mysterio? Is it going to be The Big Show? Is it going to be The Rock? No, it's Elias. That's a letdown. So if it's going to be Elias, tell us as soon as possible. Tell us on Raw. If it's not going to be Elias, if it's going to be Rey Mysterio, if it's going to be Bret Hart, if it's going to be Hulk Hogan, you know, wait till WrestleMania.
Well, I have another theory. I don't know if it's a letdown, but it's not a great surprise if it ends up being him. Because they announced Mark Henry for the Hall of Fame. Braun Strowman respects Mark Henry quite a bit. Why not give Mark Henry one last hurrah?
Because I think Braun Strowman's probably going to win the match. Whoever teams with Braun probably becomes tag team champions with Braun. And I don't see Mark Henry getting inducted into the Hall of Fame and then going on a tag team title run.
He said he's not retired.
Oh.
So.
That's weird. Why is he going into the Hall of Fame then?
Because they asked him.
I'd be fine with that. That could be a surprise. Like, if they say it's going to be a mystery partner, and then Mark Henry's music hits at WrestleMania, that's a nice little moment. It's not like, oh my God, I can't believe it's Hulk Hogan, you know?
Right.
But it's like, oh, cool, Mark Henry. That's all right. Braun and Mark Henry, That's a pretty good tag team right there. They have a little run as a tag team. I'm not mad at that. World's Strongest Tag Team.
Yeah, it's a great name. Why not?
There you go. Those are two super strong guys. Two of the strongest guys in the history of the wrestling business. So, hey, put them together. That'd be cool. Cesaro's pretty strong, but hey, how about Mark Henry and Braun Strowman? They might even be stronger.
So you're pretty sure that Strowman team's going to win, even though he's probably going to defeat Cesaro and Sheamus leading up to WrestleMania. He's already beaten Cesaro, and he's going to beat Sheamus probably next week. And he's going to win the tag match as well?
Why not?
I guess. Seems like a little much, but...
So he's going to have Mark Henry team with him, and Mark Henry's going to take the fall, and the bar's just going to keep on rolling? You need new opponents for the bar. Like, they beat everybody. They've been champions for so long. You got to do something else with them eventually.
Go to SmackDown? Or bring some teams over from SmackDown?
Yeah. I guess. John Cena came out on Raw this week. Says Undertaker's been hiding so long because he feels embarrassed for what happened. He should?
Man, you see the Roman Reigns match? Come on.
It was bad. Well, Roman should be embarrassed, too. He wasn't hiding.
Yeah, but he won the match, though.
Yeah. So Cena says he's mad that Undertaker hasn't given him an answer yet. So he's disrespecting him and the WWE Universe because Cena challenged Undertaker, and a week later, still no word on whether or not Taker's going to wrestle him at Mania. Kane showed up and hit a chokeslam on John Cena. So Undertaker's brother Kane, Hellfire and Brimstone, good God Almighty, hit that chokeslam on Cena, which seems to me like a message from the Undertaker. So it's on. We're just waiting for Taker to confirm. Maybe Druids and a casket will show up this week on Raw. And then I think the week of WrestleMania, that's when Taker shows up and accepts officially.
Well, I feel we're getting Cena versus Kane on Raw this week, no?
Are we?
I feel like that's going to happen, or if not this week, next week for sure. Because pretty much everyone on their road to WrestleMania against The Undertaker, you wrestle Kane, don't you?
Makes sense. You should. Beat the mini boss before you get the big boss.
Well,
video game style.
CM Punk didn't beat Kane, though, but yeah.
Oh, well, he didn't beat Taker either.
Nope.
And there's a reason he's no longer with the company.
Though I feel John Cena will beat Kane.
Yeah. John Cena beats everybody. I think he'll probably lose to Taker, though.
I don't know about that, but we'll see.
Yeah, you think Taker's going to win, eh? Or you think he's going to lose?
Why not? Makes sense.
I think Taker wins. The Ultimate Deletion. Main evented Raw this week. Got some pretty good reviews. Everybody seemed to like it. As did I. I thought it was fantastic. Matt Hardy beating Bray Wyatt. Officially by pinfall. There was a referee there. There was a distraction from Senor Benjamin, who was in Skarsgård, the dilapidated boat. He had a globe. He passed it to Bray Wyatt, saying he's got the whole world in his hands. Then Brother Nero appeared. That was a big surprise because, you know, with the legal issues that Brother Nero is having, we didn't know if he was going to be in the Ultimate Deletion, but he was. And he scared Bray there for a second. And then Matt was able to hit the Twist of Fate for the 1-2-3. And then he hit Bray, and Bray went into the Lake of Reincarnation. Matt told Senor Benjamin to fetch his carcass from the lake. And he wasn't there, and Matt Hardy said, "Wonderful, the Great War is now over." I thought that was fantastic. The Ultimate Deletion, you know, it had its low points. It was kind of like, yeah, they were doing the brawl by the little shack. It was kind of long. It wasn't that great. There were moments that weren't great, but overall, I thought it was fantastic. We saw the Hardy children. We saw Queen Rebecca, we saw Senor Benjamin, we saw Vanguard 1. He was a big part of the whole thing, you know, the drone that Matt Hardy has, Vanguard 1. I thought the Ultimate Deletion was really good. It felt like a continuation of everything that they were doing in TNA with the Final Deletion, Delete or Decay. This was just another chapter in the Matt Hardy universe, and I loved it.
Yeah, I don't know if it was the best, like, Final Deletion, Delete or Decay kind of segment that we've seen ever, but it definitely was pretty good. And if you're a fan of that and you've seen it before, it's kind of like going down like memory lane in a sense, watching that all over again. So that was really cool. And the fact that WWE put this in the main event of Raw made it seem like a big deal. I don't know why Michael Cole bashed it before it even aired, but that was probably Vince, because I don't know if Vince is a fan of this.
I believe that was Vince McMahon hedging his bets. I think Vince thought that it was going to fail. I think Vince thought that it was probably terrible. And he told Michael Cole to say, "Oh, I apologize in advance for what you're going to see," because Vince didn't believe in it. But a lot of people did, so he trusted them, and it was a good move to trust them, because it was great. So Vince may not have believed in it, but I think after he saw it, and after he's seen the reaction from everybody, hopefully now he's a believer, and we see more of this from Matt Hardy. Let Matt Hardy go, explore the whole Matt Hardy universe. There's a lot there. It's a great character. It's a great gimmick. This is as far as we've gone in the WWE with this gimmick. This is as much as they've exposed the Matt Hardy gimmick here, and we need more. It's a great thing. A year ago, at this time, he was the hottest thing in professional wrestling. When the Hardys showed up at WrestleMania last year, the place went insane because of the broken Matt Hardy gimmick. It's taken a long time to get here. It's kind of crazy that, you know, we had Matt Hardy last year come in at WrestleMania time, and only a year later do we see a first deletion segment at the Hardy compound. It took them a year to get to the Hardy compound with this broken gimmick, but legal battles and this and that and whatever. But now we're here. We got to keep it going. Like I said, Daniel Bryan at the Hardy compound is something I want to see. I'm not kidding about that. It's no joke. I think that would be great. I'm sure Daniel Bryan would like to do that. I think a lot of wrestlers on the roster, after seeing the Ultimate Deletion, are thinking, yeah, that'd be kind of fun to get deleted.
Yeah, Daniel Bryan should not get deleted right away, by the way. There's other things for Daniel Bryan. I think we've gone over this already, so there's no need to worry about that. What I wonder now is, you talk about WrestleMania, where's Matt Hardy on WrestleMania?
I don't know. This might have been his WrestleMania. He might just be in the Andre Battle Royal. He might just be in some sort of backstage promo. I don't know. It's a pretty sweet deal for Matt Hardy, though. Like, if they can do more of these Ultimate Deletions, doesn't have to be on the road. They literally come to him. That's his home. He gets to wrestle at home. He's working from home. He might be the only wrestler in the history of the business that gets to wrestle at home. Who else gets to work from home? Who else has worked a Raw match from home? Outside of maybe Owen Hart in the dungeon? Remember him and Ken Shamrock worked a match in the actual dungeon?
Yeah, I remember that.
That was a paper. Was that a pay-per-view or Raw? That was Raw, wasn't it?
That was a pay-per-view.
Oh, okay. Was a Lion's Den match on Raw?
Lion's Den, I think they had one.
Also a pay-per-view?
SummerSlam.
But didn't they have one on Raw, too, or something?
I feel like there were two times they did Lion's Den. It was SummerSlam. It was Owen and Steve Blackman the year, I think, after.
Okay. So Owen worked from home, technically.
Yeah. That was kind of awesome when he won, too. Like, he's going upstairs. Like, he's going to say, "Hey, Dad, I won."
Yeah, Stu's just in the kitchen while Owen is having a pay-per-view match in the basement with Ken Shamrock. "Hey, Dad, I won." Yeah, that was pretty good. Not as good as the Ultimate Deletion, though.
It was fun. Again, a lot of fun. I just hope we see more of this, and it's a shame if that's his WrestleMania. Really, WrestleMania, this is where you have to go above and beyond.
So what would you have him do?
Well, you got to obviously add Brother Nero. And let's see them do something with that.
Did you see who tweeted about it?
Who tweeted about it?
Well, a lot of people.
Hogan did, right?
That's right, brother. He said, "I'm deleted."
He is.
The WWE has deleted him. Wouldn't it be fun if Matt Hardy brought him back, though? Undeleted Hulk Hogan? There are strong rumors going around that Hogan is going to be brought back, and it might be at WrestleMania.
Well, I think WWE even stated that they're in talks, but it's going to depend on the sponsors if Hogan comes back or not. So again, if you people complain to Snickers, it's not going to happen.
Don't complain to Snickers. please bring back Terry. Everybody wants to see Hulk Hogan. Well, maybe not everybody, but I want to see Hulk Hogan big time. Can you imagine that? I just ran down the lineup of WrestleMania. You add Hulk Hogan to the mix? My goodness.
I don't think it's really necessary at this point. I mean, Hogan's not going to wrestle, by the way, so it's just an appearance.
Couldn't he do some form of ultimate deletion?
Again, an appearance. That's about it.
No, but, like, couldn't they work an angle with Hogan and Matt Hardy? Like, you think about it, these matches aren't really about the wrestling. It's more of a brawl. There's a lot of editing involved. They're all taped in advance, right?
Right.
So, who says they couldn't shoot an intricate fight scene at the Hardy compound between Matt Hardy and Hulk Hogan? And I'm not saying just Hulk Hogan, but like anybody from the past. You know, they had the Rock and Roll Express in one of them. Right?
They did, yes.
Which one was that?
Was that Delete or Decay?
I think it was Delete or Decay. That was the one where they invited all the tag teams from around the world. The Bucks of Youth, the Day of New.
Right.
So if they brought in the Rock and Roll Express, like, you know, those guys were the biggest legends that they could get when they were with TNA. But now that the Hardys are under the WWE umbrella, the legends that they could get in these ultimate deletions, I mean, it's endless how many people they could bring out. And I'm not saying work an angle between Hulk Hogan and Matt Hardy in 2018. It doesn't really make sense. But I'm just throwing out there the possibilities of it's not really about the wrestling. You don't really have to be able to take a bump. Things that don't look good can be edited out. You can look like you fall, but then you have a quick cut, and then you're down on the ground, but you didn't actually fall. There are things that they can do to make this work with a lot of different guys and a lot of different people that can't necessarily wrestle anymore. At least not wrestle a full match.
Well, I like the idea of have like an ultimate deletion invitational, kind of like the tag team thing was set up in TNA. I mean, it was pretty much supposed to be Hardys against the Decay, right? But they threw in a bunch of other people. So you can have that where Matt's maybe feuding with somebody. Maybe it's going to be Bray again. Who knows? Or is he going to be Sister Abigail now? Who knows? But make it more of an invitational where really anyone can show up. And that way you can get a Hulk Hogan appearance.
Yeah.
Actually, with WWE, you can get a whole bunch of appearances, I imagine. So it could be quite spectacular.
Ric Flair.
I'd get rid of the Andre the Giant, actually, and just, you know, throw a bunch of people in that. But
in some sort of ultimate deletion.
A lot of them should be deleted. Yeah, sure. That'd be great.
That'd be cool if we had, like, a Hardy segment at WrestleMania. Doesn't he have to be as long as what we saw on Raw there? But I would enjoy some sort of Hardy compound 5-10 minute thing at Mania.
I actually found the Raw thing was short to me. But that's what happens when you got, like, a whole episode of Impact was just that, so.
Yeah, they did, like, 2-hour,
yeah,
you know, epic things on Impact. Speaking of Impact, where's Bobby Lashley?
He'll be in WWE after WrestleMania.
Raw after Mania, is that where he's going to return?
Sounds about right.
Makes sense, right? Not the Andre Battle Royal.
That's kind of a waste, I think, for him, but.
Is it? What if he wins it?
It's like Samoa Joe. You think Samoa Joe is going to come back for the Andre the Giant? He might, but
is he physically ready to go?
They say by Mania, but he's got nothing, right? So,
yeah, that's it. This is a weird time where guys might be ready to go, but because they don't have any storylines for them right now, and WrestleMania is just around the corner, they wait on a lot of guys. They just kind of hold back. Like Big Cass apparently is ready to go, but they're like, eh. We're just going to wait a bit.
And we're going in double digits when it comes to how many matches we got from WrestleMania. Do you really need another one? I say no.
I'll just give you the card real quick because we do have 11 matches so far on this thing. The Andre the Giant Battle Royal, the Women's WrestleMania Battle Royal, Angle and Rousey versus Triple H and Stephanie, Mustafa Ali versus Cedric Alexander for the Cruiserweight title, the Raw tag titles, Braun and somebody against the Bar. The SmackDown women's title, Asuka challenging Charlotte. The Raw women's title, Nia challenging Alexa. The U.S. title, Randy defending against Bobby Roode and Jinder Mahal. A triple threat for the Intercontinental title, The Miz defending against Seth Rollins and Finn Balor. AJ Styles defending the WWE title against Shinsuke Nakamura. And Brock Lesnar defending the Universal title against Roman Reigns. 11 matches so far, and that is not including a SmackDown tag team title match. So 12, if you add that, and probably, hey, a couple of more, because Daniel Bryan and Shane McMahon versus Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn isn't on that list. So I'm counting 13 matches at least on this card.
14 to 15 sounds about right.
Woo! How long is this show supposed to be? It starts at what, 5 p.m. Eastern and ends at 11? 6 hours?
Yeah, but they can go extra, right?
Yeah, they can go longer. Could be 7.
Yeah, it's going to be a long, long day, my friend.
Yeah, it's going to be fun, though, John. It's going to be a lot of fun. Big party for WrestleMania. And, of course, the headliner, Roman Reigns, had an interesting week.
Awesome, actually. That was an amazing way to start Raw.
You like that?
I thought it was great.
Kurt Angle, in-ring promo, says Roman is still suspended and says Brock isn't there yet, but Vince says that he will be, and then Roman shows up. So Roman's suspension, you know, he's still suspended, but he doesn't care.
He came through the crowd, though.
Came through the crowd in his ring gear,
yep,
ready to go, and says he doesn't believe that Brock is going to be there. And then Angle says, you got to leave because you're suspended. And then Kurt Angle's like, oh, screw this, I'm leaving. And then three guys dressed as U.S. Marshals, or U.S. Marshals, whatever, you know, they're indie wrestlers in uniforms. They go to arrest Roman Reigns, and they handcuff him. Roman tells one of the guys not to touch him. They touch him. Roman gets mad and beats up three U.S. Marshals while handcuffed. First of all, what kind of U.S. Marshals can't take a guy who's handcuffed, okay, even though he is Roman Reigns? And second of all, shouldn't Roman Reigns be doing a lengthy prison sentence now for the assault on three police officers?
Yeah, but if that was true, Stone Cold would still be in jail for all the stuff he used to do in the Attitude Era. So,
good point. Brock Lesnar showed up while Roman was handcuffed and proceeded to beat up a handcuffed Roman Reigns. And the crowd was booing Brock, so the effect has worked. You know, the WWE trying to brainwash you into cheering for Roman Reigns and booing Brock Lesnar. When this match was announced, everybody said, go Brock, kill Roman. But then Roman tells you that Brock's not in the building. The WWE says he no-showed, and then he no-shows again, right? He no-showed two Raws in a row that he was supposedly supposed to be at, but he wasn't really supposed to be there. It's just a storyline, but people are buying into it. People are cheering for Roman Reigns because he's our guy. He's not Vince's guy. Oh, Vince's guy is Brock, not Roman. Yeah, okay. Vince's guy is Roman, but people are, you know, drinking the WWE Kool-Aid, and they're booing Brock Lesnar when he's beating up Roman Reigns, hitting him with German suplexes and chair shots and over again, hits him with F5s and just beat him up. Roman got put in a stretcher, and then Brock tipped over the stretcher. So not only is Brock now, when he finally does show up, after no-showing and disrespecting the WWE universe and disrespecting the locker room, Brock finally does show up, and he beats up Roman while he's handcuffed, so he's just a real bully and a jerk. And then when Roman is stretchered, Brock tips over the stretcher because he's just an evil, evil man that you must boo and Roman must conquer at WrestleMania. I'm not buying it. I kind of want to see both of them lose at WrestleMania. Yeah. I thought it was all right, but, you know, I feel like people are getting suckered into cheering for Roman Reigns. WWE's doing a good job. It's working. It's working on a lot of the audience. You're hearing the reactions lately for Roman and for Brock, and it seems to have flip-flopped in the past few weeks. People are easily persuaded.
I just think the action was quite good. He's handcuffed and he's giving him German suplexes.
Yeah, it's rough.
Can't protect yourself. F5, can't protect yourself.
The F5 I thought was the worst. German suplexes, you're being dumped on your back, right? I mean, your arms can help protect you, I guess.
A little, barely.
But no, when you're handcuffed, they can't. But like that was kind of rough. But I thought the F5 was worse because you can't protect your face. I mean, you're going face first, and you don't have your hands to kind of cushion the blow.
If anything, too, your hands are kind of like stuck, so if they land awkwardly, man, it's so much easier like to break your wrist or something.
Or pop your shoulders out.
Yeah, something like that. That's what I loved about it. It was like, wow, this looks really dangerous, and yet they're doing it. I don't mind that. And I think it's working, by the way. Like you said, like maybe they're booing Brock, but when they were bringing like Roman into the ambulance, people were chanting, you deserve it. So
yeah, that's true.
Still hate for Roman.
Yeah, and I think that probably will be the end reaction at WrestleMania.
Double boos?
Double boos. Wow. It's going to be like Goldberg and Brock.
I feel like people were still reacting because, again, the action was great.
Not Goldberg and Brock last time, the first time. Double boos. WrestleMania 20, I'm talking about, when, you know, you knew Brock and Goldberg were both leaving and the fans were just booing them both. And all we really wanted to see was Stone Cold Steve Austin stun both guys, which he did, which was great. And I kind of want to see Stone Cold Steve Austin be the guest ref in this match and stun both guys as well. I think that would be the best outcome. Because I feel like the fans are going to be booing Brock because they know he's leaving and because of the storyline and the way it's been booked. But then the fans are also going to be like, wait a second, it's Roman Reigns. We hate Roman Reigns. And they're also going to be booing Roman because I think maybe there's some love for Roman now because he's not champion yet. But as soon as he beats Brock and he's crowned champion, everybody's going to wake up from this dream and say, wait a second, Roman's the guy. They just gave Roman the title. They're giving everything to him. Boo. Boo this man. And I think that's what's going to happen. I think they're both going to get a lot of heat from the crowd, which is another reason why I don't think their match should close the show. It should be Charlotte and Asuka. Because I feel like no matter who wins there, people will go home happy. And I feel like with Roman and Brock, no matter who wins, people are going to be mad. If Brock wins, people are going to be mad. If Roman wins, people are going to be mad. If Charlotte wins, you're happy for Charlotte. She conquered Asuka. She's the queen. If Asuka wins, she's won her first title on the main roster. She continues her streak. She ends WrestleMania. She deserves it. I think that should be the end of the show.
Well, I just look at the match that they focus the most on, and it seems to be Roman versus Brock. All the other matches, they're all given time, but it really seems like Roman versus Brock is the most important. Maybe you could say Cena Undertaker as well. Again, those two matches, to me, those are the main events.
Maybe Cena Taker closes the show.
I have no problem with that.
Me neither. I have no problem with The Undertaker closing WrestleMania. It just feels right.
Though you do have two world championship matches, and they're not going to main event, and they didn't main event last year, so what does that say?
Well, AJ and Shinsuke aren't main eventing. We know that. That's not happening. It's not happening.
To a lot of people, that is the main event of WrestleMania.
I know, but it's probably going to be somewhere in the middle of the card.
Unfortunately, yeah.
Yeah. Could be best match on the card, but I think it's going to be somewhere in the middle. I think Roman and Brock could close the show. I think Asuka and Charlotte could close the show. I think Taker and Cena could close the show as well. I don't think Ronda's going to close the show. I think that'll be somewhere towards the end, but not quite at the end.
Yeah, it feels like maybe last hour.
Yeah.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah. John, we got to close this show. We're out of time. When's your next match? When can people see you in the ring?
It's going to be April 22nd for Torture Chamber. Bell time is 2 p.m., 4325 Industrial Boulevard. Tickets, $5. And I'm wrestling for the NWA British Commonwealth Championship.
Against Drew Onyx.
Not Drew Onyx. Oh. Alex North is the champion. I'm wrestling him. Drew Onyx, NWA Canadian Tag Champ.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And you're challenging him this weekend.
That's right. Well, I already challenged him today.
That's right.
And we'll talk about it next week.
That's right. On the Wrestling Uncensored pre-show, which you can hear on WrestlingUncensored.net. You can subscribe to our iTunes feed. Leave a comment. Give us a 5-star rating. Always appreciated. helps us out. WrestlingUncensored.net. We're on YouTube as well. RingsideReport.net on YouTube, the YouTube channel. All our shows are up there. On Google Play, on the TuneIn Radio app, wherever you get your podcasts, we are there. Follow Johnny North on Twitter at North Genesis. You can follow me at Dave Simon MMA. Big thank you to Jimmy and Marco for helping us out at TSN 690. And a thank you to you for listening. 2 weeks away from WrestleMania. For Johnny North, I am Dave Simon, and this has been Wrestling Uncensored. Yes! Yes! Yes!
No. No.
No. Not knowing that disconnect from the father, the next generation will be the real victims. I can't fault them, really. I remember Amber told my boy, no matter what happens, she ain't going back to Philly. Back to our regularly scheduled programming of weak content and slow jamming.